Melinda presents this unabridged recording of
Outback Songman, My Life, written and read by Ted Egan.
Ted Egan, Chapter 1, The Coldest Day. My mum constantly said, "Teddy, you were born on the coldest day for 30 years. When I eventually looked up the newspapers of that day, 6 July 1932, it was described as a normal Melbourne winter's day. Early morning frosts and fogs, rain later. Things haven't changed. I guess life seemed somewhat bitter to Grace, my ma, having her fourth baby, first boy, in the middle of winter during the worst financial depression Australia and the world had known. I was born at home, 4 Higginbotham Street, Coburg. Nurse Regan was the midwife. I weighed in at a fairly hefty 5.5 k's, 12 pounds in those days. For my first 5 years, Dad was out of permanent work due to the depression. He rode his bike to Melbourne every day seeking jobs at the Labor Office, but was often on the dole. Our house was mortgaged to the State Savings Bank of Victoria, where Dad had managed to do a deal with the bank by paying off a mere sixpence each week, just to keep in touch. My three sisters were Patricia, Pat, born on St. Patrick's Day, 1923, aged 9, Margaret, Peg, was 7, and Shirley, Sal, was almost 2. Mum was Grace Brennan, born at Banyina, in Western Victoria, on 8 March 1901, the daughter of Peter Brennan, an Irish-born farmer, who'd married Martha Williams, a native of Australia, as white people born in this country were then classified. My dad, Joe Egan, was born at Timboon, Western Victoria, on 26 January 1898. Throughout his life, he thought his parents were John Egan, born in Tipperary Island, and Ellen Hogan, another native. Years later, we learned otherwise. Our neat little suburban house was built of weatherboard with a galvanised iron roof. It had 2 bedrooms, a lounge room, a dining room, which was in fact a spare bedroom for the many relatives who visited regularly. There was a bathroom, but we didn't have reticulated hot water when it was bath night. We'd carry buckets of hot water from the washhouse where Mum had a wood-fired copper. We had a good-sized kitchen with first a wood, later a gas stove. We didn't even have an ice chest until 1941. There was a dresser storing foodstuffs and a cool-guardy safe with wet hessian walls where butter and meat were kept cool. All of my childhood I slept on the back porch adjacent to the washhouse. In the backyard was a lavatory, fortunately sewered. We had many country relations whose houses still had the old dunny can, and we cityites used to dread going to the lav when we visited them. When did we start to use words like toilet and loo? In the spacious backyard we had a clothesline, a cricket pitch, a big plum tree, and from time to time, chooks and vegetable gardens. My first infant memory was starting school at St. Paul's in 1936, aged 3. I don't know why Grace sent me to school so early, but it was a handicap for my entire school life. I was always the youngest in my class and became an absolute smartass, convinced I could get away with murder. I never had problems with lessons or passing exams, but I gave some fine teachers hell and didn't grasp the fundamentals of anything in real terms. We lived a narrow, xenophobic lifestyle. As Irish Catholics, we felt very free to ridicule anybody who was not just like us. If we weren't having a party, which wasn't a lavish affair, but simply singing and dancing in the lounge room, there was constant political consideration of what the English did to the Irish. Or there were card games. Oh, two Irish priests, Fathers Lynch and Duggan, were regular visitors for a game called 45s, and the table shook as players trumped one another's cards. Our family delights in recalling a night when, at 11:30 p.m, Father Lynch recalled he had not finished saying his office, the Latin panegyric that all priests had to recite daily aloud. He retired briefly from the game, knelt in the corner of the room where he rattled off the remainder of his office. He then returned to the table saying, "Right now, who led that bloody ace?" The Sisters of Mary who taught us at school wore long black habits with a thick leather belt and long rosary beads that rattled ominously at their waists. Starched white coifs framed their faces and gave them awe-inspiring countenances. Very occasionally, a wisp of hair was erotically exposed, but the most striking thing was they had no ears. There were two long-term lay teachers, Miss White in grade 5 and Cocky Reardon, who taught grade 3. Cocky's nickname derived from her high-pitched voice, but she was a great favourite and an excellent teacher, much loved for her mannerisms, her beautiful copperplate handwriting, and unforgettable teaching methods. I have only a few specific memories pre-1939 when war broke out. I remember vividly, though, how few cars there were. The residents of Higginbotham Street were all working-class people, and only two or three families had cars. That left the street free for all the horse-drawn vehicles. The Milky came with his four-wheel cart in the early hours and filled the billy can left on the front veranda. His horse moved slowly from house to house. The Baker was a different turnout altogether. His was a light two-wheeled jinker with a bread box at the back of a high precarious seat. He came mid-morning, travelling at a brisk trot, coming to absolute stops, whereupon he would run to about six houses, one after the other, calling, "Baker!" as he delivered lovely, hot, crusty, high tin loaves, accepting cash payments in each case. Mr. Howlett delivered wood in the winter and ice in summer to those lucky enough to have ice chests. He was a kind man who always chipped us a piece of ice, which we wrapped in our hankies to make it last longer. Mr. Howlett's wagon was pulled by two Shetland ponies, and we loved to pat those sturdy little animals. Mr. Howlett's beautiful daughter Glenys was stricken with infantile paralysis in the awful polio epidemic. We wheeled her to school in a long, flat pram. The dustman, lesser Sydneysiders called him the Garbo, came with a dray, pulled by a big Clydesdale draft horse twice a week. As the driver emptied the rubbish tins onto his dray, the huge horse would stand to attention, never moving an inch, but we always tried to be around, as there was the prospect of getting some horse manure for the garden. We were fascinated, as the horse often, without a care in the world, disdainfully lifted its tail and had a chaffy, steaming shit. Occasionally there'd be a fish man or a fruit man, but in the main, fruit, vegetables and meat were available at the nearby shops in a Hayes Road. Fish and chips, vital to Catholics, who were not allowed to eat meat on Fridays, were purchased at the shop near the railway line that ran from Coburg to the city, 5 miles, 8 kilometres away. There was also a very efficient number 19 tram service to the city. The postman came twice a day. It's sobering to reflect that in those times, a letter posted in Geelong late afternoon was delivered at 10 a.m. next day in suburban Melbourne. Given the absence of cars, games in the street were great fun, especially in summer. Boys and girls played together with parents, sitting on their front verandas or patches of lawn supervising. There would be cricket, footy, hide-and-seek, release, hoppo-bumpo, branders, Simon Says. Oh, the fun of it, eh? I go back to Higginbotham Street nowadays. There are no trees, and you just can't imagine how all those games were played on such a grand scale. It's the cars. They have displaced the trees and stopped the games. And I feel so sorry for kids these days with all their smartphones, video games and electronic toys. yet they are constantly bored. Never once was I bored at a child. Never once. Ted Egan, Chapter 2. So much happened in 39. It was to be a long time before I knew anything about the facts of life, so I was absolutely amazed when on New Year's Day 1939 my brother came into the world, weighing a massive 7 kilogram, 15 pounds. I'd been sent off to Ballarat on the train for the day with my old uncle, J.P. Williams, along with my sisters. When we returned, Grace was sitting up in bed. We had a new brother. Easy as that. "What's his name?" I asked. "Francis Geoffrey. He'll be called Geoffrey." Nobody ever knew where she got those names. 1939 was off to a good start, we thought, but that soon changed. Black Friday, 13 January 39, saw bushfires raging all over Victoria, New South Wales and South Australia. 71 Victorians were burnt to death on that day, and the nation was in a state of shock. And then Germany invaded Poland in September 1939. No one was surprised, really, even though there were stark reminders of the horrors of World War I in the shape of the thousands of wounded old diggers still in our midst. Nobody demurred when new Prime Minister Menzies took us into the war on the side of Mother England. "Get it over and done with," most said. "Good for the economy," others reckoned. Grace just shook her head and said, "They'll never learn, will they?" Most young men and some women rushed to enlist. What amazed me was the speed with which sleepy Australia mobilised. Who made those uniforms so quickly? The badges, the boots, the hats, the guns, the bullets, the aeroplanes even. The paradox with war is that the armourers all seem to have it planned in advance. The starkest reminders of World War I were the sad old veterans who manned the lifts in all the big city stores and offices in Melbourne. They sat on their stools with one or no legs, their crutches beside them at all times. "What are you thinking now?" I wondered. "You wasted the leg, didn't you? It's on again." Even though we were 12,000 miles away from the action, Melbourne was buzzing with excitement from the outset. The wharves at Port Melbourne rang out with "Waltzing Matilda" and "The Maori's Farewell" as the wild colonial boys again sailed to war. My sisters, Pat and Peg, were both teenagers. They both got jobs at the Royal Arcade Hotel in the city, Pat as a bar attendant in the ladies' bar and Peg as a secretary typist. They both, in their different ways, participated in the hectic social life that prevailed around all the servicemen and women. They both took up smoking, which was novel for women, but de rigueur for all young men. Peg loved dancing. Pat was not so keen, but they both attended socials and dance parties, commanding the attention of many young swains as they were both good-looking, both very smart dressers. The cigarette companies had us all by the throat, metaphorically. The figures on the wireless and in posters promoting smoking were, ironically, the world's leading singers, who assured us that the smoothness of the cigarettes was the reason why they all sang so beautifully. Smoking was permitted in cinemas, and it was fascinating that every time Spencer Tracy lit a cigarette for Katharine Hepburn, the audience would all light up and puff and cough in unison. Later, the models for cigarette advertising became the soldiers themselves, telling us to make Raven A fags in their ACF, Australian Comforts Fund, parcels. I began to compile quite impressive and comprehensive war books based on the daily wireless reports and the movements of our many cousins who joined the armed services. That knowledge was given a boost when, late in 41, I began at age 9 to sell evening newspapers. My stand was on the corner of Bell Street and Sydney Road, Coburg, in front of Brown's Pub, right at the Coburg Tram Terminus, always a busy spot but teeming with people now that the war was in full swing. I would cross from the pub to attend each departing and arriving tram. I became expert at swinging from one tram to another on the wrong side, risking a kick in the bum from the conductor each time. I threaded through the crowds of men in the public bar, no women allowed, and witnessed the barbarity of the 6 o'clock swill, where blokes drank as many beers as they could before the pubs closed peremptorily at 6 p.m, when they all staggered onto the street and bar staff hosed the premises. Most of my school holidays were spent at Dennington near Warrnambool, Western Victoria.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.